Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello, my name is Dr. Himanshu Tyagi and I am teaching this course on heat and mass transfer. Today will be our 13th lecture, which is titled Introduction to Convection. So today we will be starting a new topic related to convective heat transfer. Before we start, let us look at the recap of previous lecture, which was titled Finite Difference Method Part 2. So in that method we had completed the matrix formation of 1D steady state, and we had started for 1D transient heat conduction, and this is the result that we obtain for transient heat conduction inside a plane wall. So we are assuming one dimensional heat conduction taking place, as shown by this red arrow over here. This progression of this red arrow actually indicates the increase in time. So our time is increasing over here. And we got very good results for this particular set of exercise. So we started with developing the 1D transient analysis equations. We started off with the general energy balance equation over here. We discretized the whole thing, and then we did it for the first interior node. So we did the calculation for node 3 as shown in the red box over here. And what we did was, we had divided the whole wall into 5 nodes, and we wanted to figure out the temperature for each of these nodes at various time intervals. So the first thing we did was, we figured out the general equation for any interior node, which is given by this particular yellow box over here. Then we went on to figure out the equation for both the exterior nodes N1 and N2. Based on these 5 equations, and we have 5 variables T1 to T5, I think we had completed this exercise by looking at the concept of solving this particular matrix, where A and B are constants. So these 2 are constants over here, and only thing which is unknown is the temperature. So at each time interval, we can calculate the value of temperature by focusing on the previous time step temperature. That is what these superscripts I plus 1 stand for. And today we will be starting convection. Before that, let us briefly recap what we have covered throughout all the lectures for conduction. I think we started off with very simple steady state one dimensional conduction. We looked at lot of examples inside the plane wall. So if I may draw it over here once again, I think we looked at various temperature profiles over here. Then we had assumed convection taking place on the left hand side and as well as on the right hand side over here. So we figured out that how would the temperature profile look like in such case, as well as the case where energy generation is taking place, and it could be asymmetrical boundary condition, which means T1 is not equal to T2. We also looked at the general equation in 3 dimension for Cartesian coordinates or in rectangular systems. We also looked at analysis of the thermal resistance network, where we drew, for instance, for this particular case, the same problem we could solve by using thermal resistance network like this, and we could even add networks in series as well as in parallel. So these resistance we are adding in series and in parallel. So a lot of techniques we have analyzed, and we did that for cylindrical and spherical cases as well. So over here also we can add resistances. We looked at the interesting concept of the critical radius of insulation, and then we moved on into transient conduction, and we tried to solve it using 3 different methods: one term approximation, then we looked at Heisler charts as well, and finally we finished the whole conduction thing with a deep analysis of one of the numerical methods, which is the finite difference method. So with that understanding of conduction behind us, now let us move on to the new set of topic, which is convective heat transfer. So we will be looking at convection around us, and today's lecture and a few more lectures are actually dedicated to introducing the concepts as well as the fundamentals of convective heat transfer. So, we will start the question by asking the general question which is on our mind is that what exactly is convective heat transfer. So, let me put the question over here. What is convective heat transfer? As you can see over here, some static and dynamic images of fluids and the interaction inside fluid is actually taking place over here. So, I will explain the logic behind putting this figure over in this slide in just a little while. Let me go back and answer this particular question. So, convection is taking place wherever there is a fluid, mechanics is taking place and some sort of a temperature gradient is there. In other words, so I can answer this question which I have written over here, what is convective heat transfer, in many ways. So, if there is an equation form I can write, so I can just say that is this Q dot convection we know is convective heat transfer coefficient multiplied by surface area multiplied by surface temperature and the ambient air temperature. I can also show it graphically. So, if there is some sort of area that is known to us, let us say this surface has area AS, its temperature is TS and it is surrounded by all sides with the fluid and I put some sort of a fan over here. This fluid is moving with some velocity u infinity and certain temperature of the fluid is T infinity. So, if TS is greater than T infinity, this particular surface is going to lose heat in the form of convective heat transfer and that value we have given over here. So, for convective heat transfer to take place, we need to have some sort of a solid surface and it should be surrounded with fluid and there will be a motion of that particular fluid. So, if we look around in nature, in fact, I can make a general statement that all human being, animals, all our ecosystem, we are surrounded everywhere with fluids. It could be water, it could be air, sometimes the air composition changes, somewhere oxygen is higher, somewhere water vapor is higher. Even inside our body, the statistics show that human body is made up of about 60% water and most of our systems which are taking place inside the body like respiratory system, blood circulation system, digestion, excretion system, all of them are predominantly run because of the fluids. So, they are fluid based systems. So, there is lot of fluid inside us, we are surrounded by fluid and if for instance, I am consuming some tea or coffee over here, then if there is some temperature gradient, then in addition to the fluid motion, in addition to fluid mechanics, then convective heat transfer also takes place. So, this is the answer that I like to give for this particular question, that there are some fluid mechanics is there and then if we add to that a particular temperature gradient, then we have convective heat transfer taking place. And now, I can keep on talking about in the next few minutes, I will talk a lot about introducing some terms related to convective heat transfer. And I will also explain to the students that in the next around 10 to 12 lectures, we will look at convective heat transfer in lot of detail. And what do I mean by that? So, even without explaining what is convection heat transfer, just to give a glimpse of what we are going to look at. So, we will look at various phenomena and we will try to categorize. So, whenever we try to learn something new or a new phenomena or a new material, we try to classify it. So, if some new around 100 years ago people were discovering new elements like argon gas, neon gas, new metals, uranium, plutonium. So, if you remember from our periodic table, they were always classified in certain categories. Then that classification we can also do over here for convective heat transfer. So, the first category that we will make is that whether this convective heat transfer is forced. So, this is one type of convective heat transfer. Or it is free and in the free case it is also known as the natural convection. So, convection can either be forced or it can be free. So, we will generally start with this type of classification and based on this several topics we will be studying in the next few lectures. For instance, we will look at the fundamentals of convection. So, for short, I will just write it as CONV, convection. Then we will look at the forced convection, and that also we will divide it into two parts, whether it is external type of flow or internal type of flow. So, this is a classification because a major portion of the physics behind the convective heat transfer is determined by the fluid properties and the flow properties, which is why, now we go back to the slide over here, this is the motivation behind putting both these figures over here, that fluid mechanics is a very predominant form, predominant component of convective heat transfer. And as we can see in these pictures over here, we will look at it picture again after few slides, and we will try and analyze what type of flow are we looking at. And in the bottom, we will try to ask questions that some sort of a dispersion is going on over here. So, if I write this dispersion, and let me call it this one as glass A over here and this one as glass B. So, we will be able to deduce just by looking at this moving picture over here, this is a GIF file, that which of them is actually having higher temperature. So, believe it or not, just by looking at the dispersion of the yellow color which is spreading inside over here. So, I will just give a hint, this yellow color which is added to both glasses is some sort of a naturally occurring dye. So, it is a yellow food dye. Dye is anything which gives color. So, if I am wearing a blue shirt one day or a red shirt one day, so the cotton which is white has been dyed with a particular color. So, over here that dye actually, how does it disperse, how fast the diffusion of that species takes place, it will be linked with the mass, momentum and heat together. So, if you remember in some of the slides earlier, I had talked about it. So, there are so many things which are interconnected. So, convection, if I may say, out of the three modes of heat transfer, conduction, convection and radiation, convection is the most interesting one, and at the same time it is also a little bit complicated. A lot of mathematics is needed in that, and lot of classifications we can look at it by for studying it. So, let me continue with the way what I was writing about classification over here. So, first we will look at fundamentals of convection, then we will look at external type of forced convection. Then we will go ahead and look at internal forced convection, and of course, we will also look at natural convection. Then there are two limiting cases for convection. One is the limiting case in physics, which we call as the phase change. So, we look at that problem as well. So, phase change could be, in this particular course, I am going to concentrate on boiling as well as condensation. So, I am just abbreviating with B and C. And finally, we will look at one of the best examples of convection around us. So, we abbreviate, it is called heat exchanger. So, in our community, heat exchangers are abbreviated with HXN. So, this stands for heat exchangers. So, it is a device where fluids are present on two sides. So, they actually exchange the heat with one another. So, this is the heat exchanger. So, in the next 10 to 12 lectures, we will be talking at all these topics one by one. But the most important topic that I believe is actually the fundamental. So, we will learn the fundamental physics behind what exactly is convection. And the beauty of convection is, even though it is the most complicated of all the modes of heat transfer, if you look at the equation written on this particular slide and I put a box around it, so this is one of the simplest equations which is around, and the only thing which bothers which makes life difficult for engineers is this heat, convective heat transfer coefficient H. So, in other words, all these things that we will study in the next 10-12 lecture is just to answer one question. So, it is kind of a holy grail problem, that what is the value of H. Because if somebody gives to us engineers the value of H, then the problem is solved already. Like you remember in the last 10 lectures for conduction, everywhere, if I go back two slides over here, everywhere we were assuming that the temperature of air and the convective heat transfer coefficient is known to us. So, T, L and H L for left side. Similarly, T, R and H R for the right side. So, you may try to remember in this way that in all the convection lectures, now we will try and figure out that how do we know the value of H L, how do we know the value of H R. In the best example, so I will start this particular topic with certain examples. So, first example I have given already over here, that this could be a surface which is actually losing heat. What are the other examples from life? This is another example that I was talking about. So, if I have a hot cup of tea or coffee and it is so hot that I can't drink it. So, I think we have all gone through that experience. So, what we try and do is there are two alternatives. One is I can leave it for a little while. Through natural convection, it will cool by itself. So, now we are talking about this topic over here, natural convection. But let us say that particular day I was very in lot of hurry. I am not able to wait for that long for it to cool. So, we all have that experience that we will blow some air over it. And in our house, we have lot of children. They are not able to eat hot chapati or let us say hot food like samosa. So, they always bring it to us. Like I have a 8-year-old daughter at home. Her name is Tanya. So, I help her cool that particular object by either breaking it into small pieces, like if it is a big chapati, I break it into small pieces, or just blow hot air over it. I can also do it, automate the process by putting a fan over here. So, if there is a fan whose air is actually directed over here, then the temperature will drop much faster. What are other examples? If I am standing in this room, let us say, and I have an air conditioner present over here. The indoor unit is known as the evaporator. So, what is happening over here is that there are set of tubes usually made of copper in which chilled refrigerant is actually passing over here and it gets evaporated. And because of that, it takes away heat from this room and in turn it is actually cooling our air. So, let us say the air from this particular room, when it was going over this tube earlier, the temperature was 30 degree. Because it was slightly hotter. This is the temperature of air which is flowing over the copper tube, and while it comes out over here, then my temperature is much less, maybe around 25 degrees. So, forced convection is taking place over here as well, which means that whenever we look or stand close to our air conditioner unit, we can always see hear some noise of a small blower or a small fan which is actually taking the hot air from this particular room, circulating it over the cold coils and then bringing it back over here. The same thing is happening in our refrigerator as well. If I open the chamber where ice usually freezes, so I will see some sort of a metal sheet behind which lot of coils are present. So, refrigerant is running inside that coil, and that is the same section like we have shown over here, that is the evaporator of the refrigerator in which very low temperature refrigerant is flowing. So, in the interest of completion over here, I can say this refrigerant TR, maybe it enters at very low temperature over here 5 degrees and it goes out T refrigerant at higher temperature, or at least its phase changes. So, over here it is kind of, so I will use some technical language, it may be saturated liquid, and when it comes out over here, it may be saturated fluid. So, mechanical engineers would understand what I am talking about. I may even draw the TS diagram for this particular process in which I can show that at constant temperature, because of phase change taking place, it is actually removing heat from this particular room, or in the case of refrigerator, it is removing heat from inside that refrigeration chamber. These are some examples come to our mind. Then the same principle is actually happening in power plants. There are boilers sections over there and condenser sections. So, in boiler we are adding heat through convective heat transfer, one of the ways, and in the condenser we are dumping heat or taking it away and putting it to the atmosphere. The same thing is happening inside every electronic component. So, if you look inside a laptop, I remember I had shown those slots earlier, if you turn a laptop upside down, on the bottom side there will be lot of slots which are actually shown over there that allows the air to go in, cool the motherboard and the chip and then come out slightly hotter. So, in all these examples, whether it is very simple, a surface of area A like this, or hot cup or having certain complicated geometry, or our body which is actually losing heat. So, if the room temperature is 25, I am continuously losing heat through convection, and if I want to increase that amount of heat transfer, I can switch on the fan. So, in all these particular cases, I can have either natural convection or forced convection taking place. By the way, I have not formally defined any of that. I will define it in just a minute. I just wanted to give certain examples that we all see around us in day-to-day life. Then I will formally define some of them. I will also ask questions like, if the holy grail, like I mentioned, is the value of H. If you are so interested in value of H, this heat transfer coefficient, what are some ways, what are some of the things on which it actually depends? Of whose property is it a function of? So, for instance, I have shown earlier that if I want to cool my tea much more faster, I can blow over it or switch on, make the air go, fan go faster and faster. So, one property it seems it is dependent on is velocity. What are other properties that it is dependent on? So, again, I will move on to next slide over here. These are things we will study in the next 10 to 12 lectures, but today I just wanted to give a glimpse that what are all the things that we are going to study in those lectures, so that we can all connect it with our day-to-day experience. So, if you ask this question that what is actually H going to be dependent on? So, the formal answer I can give very quickly is maybe I will hold on to that for a little while. So, one or two ways in which I can write it over here is that it is dependent on several factors, including fluid properties, the flow properties. So, the first one is velocity, it is flow property, then maybe some of the thermal parameters. I think students can immediately recognize that I am writing thermal conductivity, density, specific heat, then some fluid properties like mu, which is viscosity. Then there are certain things which we have not studied yet, the expansion coefficient and the gravity as well, then characteristic length as well as the temperature of surface and the temperature of air. So, in other words, if you look at this function, it is kind of very complicated. So, do not worry about that, slowly and slowly we will make it less complicated. I just want to give an overall picture, that is why I am sharing all this information over here. And then how do we make these things less complicated? For that, we will go for the formal approach. So, we will start very slowly, one by one we will try to analyze that what is natural convection, what is forced convection, and how does gravity play a role in actually cooling things, because we know that if we put our hot cup of tea in this room, then it will heat up the air which is surrounding it. That air, because of buoyancy, will actually rise because its density has decreased when temperature increases. So, some sort of a natural circulation cycle current will be formed over here, and that actually is one of the ways by which this hot cup of tea will lose its heat. So, that one is the force free convection, or called the natural convection. And if I want to replace this with a blowing air using some sort of a fan or a mechanical power like my hand or the lung power that I have, then it will be termed as the forced convection. So, these are things that we will look into more detail, but the first thing that I wanted to do today is go back to this particular slide over here, and having given some overview about convective heat transfer, I want to focus on the first part of convection, which according to this blue box or the orange box that I am making the border over here, is that convection, because it cannot take place without a fluid. So, let us go ahead and look at some of the basics of fluid mechanics, that what are the properties of the fluid, and if we have a very complicated fluid in which mass exchange is taking place, momentum exchange, and later on heat transfer we will add to it, then how do we start from the very basics? So, with that motivation in mind, let us start from a fresh slide over here and look at some background behind fluid mechanics, that how does the property, the behavior of the flow actually take place. And we will start with very simple examples and then go on further and further. So, in one very simple way, I can define inside a flow which could be taking place. So, let me take a very simple case and define something called the shear stress. So, this is the equation for shear stress. So, tau represents shear stress. And its units are Newton per meter square. And where would this shear stress take place? If I draw certain cases over here, let me draw a flow taking place inside a pipe. This is the first case, and the second case is if there is a flat plate somewhere over here and then flow is taking place above it. So, inside the pipe, if I draw that thing in more detail, so we will make some classification of flows as well, and over here what we will figure out is if the flow is laminar and it is fully developed, then the velocity profile inside this particular pipe actually becomes parabolic. So, it becomes something like this. These arrows length indicate the magnitude of the velocity over here. If I put the axis over here as r, because it is a pipe, so I am talking in terms of radius and distance along x axis, then I can say this velocity u is actually a function of r in the case of fully developed flow. And we will figure out that if in addition to it being fully developed, the flow is also laminar, then the shape turns out to be a parabola. And it may appear something like this. If the radius of the pipe is known to me as r naught, then it would be u max 1 minus r square by r naught square. So, I am jumping ahead a little bit because I have not defined what is fully developed, I have not defined what is laminar right now. So, I will come back to that in just a minute, because there are certain parameters that I wanted to define first. So, in this particular case, we can clearly see over here that u del u by del y, or in this particular case it will become del u by del r, is actually the velocity gradient. So, I can write it over here that this represents the velocity gradient. And this parameter mu is the dynamic viscosity. And the units for that is Newton second per meter square. And because I am making certain definitions, let me also define a parameter called nu, which is simply mu divided by rho, where rho is the density, and we usually give it in kgs per meter cube. And this nu over here is also a viscosity, but we call it the kinematic viscosity. And I think this is something that we have discussed earlier, and if students do not remember, I will recall them that what was the unit of kinematic viscosity, remind us of. So, the units as written in this slide is meter square per second. So, if you remember in the last 3-4 lectures, there was some thermal parameter which had the similar unit, and that one was alpha, and alpha stood for thermal diffusivity. And it had the same unit, meter square per second. And the students may also recall that earlier I had also talked about the mass diffusivity. So, if I talk about mass diffusivity as well, then I will write over here mass diffusivity, which is usually given as the symbol D with the small subscript A, and its units are also same, meter square per second. So, what I am trying to link over here, if I can write over here, that viscosity is something which links with the momentum of the flow. So, momentum diffusivity, heat diffusivity and mass diffusivity are actually all interlinked together because they have the same units as one another. So, they are all three parameters are linked, interlinked with one another. Okay. Now, can we go back to the first slide which had shown this animation over here. So, this animation is actually an example of mass diffusivity. And that is because just like if we add certain amount of heat to a particular body, that heat will diffuse throughout it. And this we usually observe in our real life, that if we take a big copper rod and just heat one part of that copper rod and then just leave it, that heat will actually spread throughout the wall, throughout the rod, and the whole rod will attain a uniform temperature. So, that is the principle of diffusion. The same thing we can experience in our teacup as well. If I take a spoon and I stir certain portion of the teacup and then just leave it like that, so that momentum that I have given actually diffuses all across the cup, so that the whole fluid actually attains a slightly lower velocity, but everything is then moving over there, then it the momentum has diffused. And in this animation that we are seeing over here, it is actually the species in the sense that we have added some yellow dye, because if you see at the time it was being added, both the glasses A and B were totally transparent, so both were pure water. Then we add some sort of a yellow color to it, then just by diffusion that actually spreads throughout, and we can see that it is spreading more in A than in B. And this is one of the ways which we can figure out or get a hint that usually this diffusion, because it is linked with Brownian motion, and this is one of the reasons that I can add some sugar to my milk and even without stirring it, if I leave it maybe for half an hour or so, and if it is the hot tea, then just by diffusion, because the Brownian motion of vibration of atoms and molecules is taking place very rigorously inside the tea, especially if it is hot. If it is slightly cold, so that Brownian motion is slightly less. And so, what we see in this particular slide is that TA is greater than TB, because in A immediately all that particular species is diffused much faster as compared to B. So, that was the reason for putting that image over there. Now, we come back to the study of fluid mechanics, and these are some basic parameters that I am defining over here: shear stress, then dynamic viscosity and kinematic viscosity. In the same line, let me go ahead and define one more parameter, which will be, I think it is familiar to engineering students, and this is called the Reynolds number. And this is dimensionless because it is essentially a ratio of two type of forces, and whose expression turns out to be something like this, rho v l divided by mu. So, it is the ratio of the inertial force divided by the viscous force. And if you do the arithmetic, then the relationship turns like this. Over here everything is known to us, rho is the density, v is the characteristic velocity of the fluid, mu is the dynamic viscosity of the fluid, and L over here is the characteristic length of the particular object on which our focus is. If we are taking, if we are concentrating on flow across a cylinder or a sphere, then that characteristic length is over here the diameter. So, I can put a LC over here, that is the characteristic length. If I am interested in flow taking place over a flat plate over here, then my characteristic length over here is this length L. And similarly, lot of automobile companies, they actually do testing in wind tunnels. So, if this is a car over here, so they are interested in the flow taking place over here because they want the flow to remain streamlined. So, this is the flow which is taking place, I will put arrows over here. So, then here again the characteristic length is this particular length L over here. Now comes the interesting part, that Reynolds number is named after the scientist Reynolds, and he had a very important contribution to make, that throughout the world wherever some flow is taking place, it is observed that whatever is the dynamic viscosity of the flow, whatever is the length of that particular object that we are interested in, whatever is the density of the fluid, whatever is the velocity, we can all combine it together for particular types of flow with just one number, and that is the Reynolds number. And this Reynolds number, the most significant thing what it tells is that when will the flow remain laminar, it kind of gives an indication, and when will the flow become turbulent. So, I have lot of photographs over here that I will show, that what do we mean by laminar flow and what do we mean by turbulent flow. So, I will just draw some animation. In the laminar flow taking place inside the pipes, velocity profile is usually very straight and uniform. Over here the velocity profile is, so in turbulent lot of eddies are there. So, I can draw some eddies over here as well, so some eddies in the counterclockwise, clockwise direction, lot of vorticity is generated over here. So, we have lot of randomness in the flow, and what Reynolds had actually observed, that in pipes the critical Reynolds number CR, Reynolds critical, is about 2300, which means no matter what is the diameter of the pipe, what type of fluid am I taking, what is the velocity of the fluid, as long as I just calculate this number, I can kind of predict. Of course, this is for smooth pipes under zero vibration and under lot of ideal conditions, but this is a universal kind of a number that people have observed throughout different laboratories around the world, that if the flow is having Reynolds number flow inside the pipe. So, I will write over here flow in pipes, in smooth pipes, then up to a value of Reynolds number equal to 2300, the flow usually remains laminar. So, which means if the Reynolds number is less than 2300 for flow inside the pipe, then it is laminar. If we increase it to greater than 2300, then it suddenly becomes turbulent. So, it first becomes, there is a transition, and then it becomes turbulent, and the same thing is observed for flow over a flat plate. So, if we have a flat plate over here, and we have another flat plate over here, so over here the critical Reynolds number in this particular case is taken to be about 5 × 10⁵. So, we will see that there is something called the boundary layer, and if we have the longer plate, then the boundary layer becomes turbulent over here. So, this is the laminar region, laminar, and this is the turbulent region, and this zigzag thing in between, this over here, this is known as the transition. So, this is the transition zone that we will be talking about. So, if I were a student and I was listening to this lecture, then question may come to my mind that, sir, I wanted to look at the fundamentals of convection, but why are you going into details of fluid mechanics? So, the answer behind that would be that if you go back one slide and we see over here, this is one of the most powerful relationship that people have actually observed, that there is some sort of symmetry going on between momentum, heat and mass. So, in order to understand the best way how the heat transfer will take place inside a pipe where the flow is laminar, then we have to study how the flow actually takes place inside that particular pipe, the momentum exchange how it takes place, and with that idea in mind, I had actually shown this particular figure over here. So, I think our viewers, the students may be able to see over here clearly that there is a zone over here where the fluid is highly turbulent. So, you can see lot of eddies, vorticity, lot of motion of the water in all the directions. And if you see upstream over here in this particular zone, the water flow is very smooth, there are no eddies which are visible, then we can clearly see that actually laminar flow must be taking place over there. And for observing this difference between laminar and turbulent, we do not have to go to a big river or to a dam like or barrage like structure as shown in this figure. We can actually see it in our house. So, we have all seen some smoke coming out of a particular candle or an agarbatti. Usually it is a straight line initially and then it becomes very zigzag scattered. So, I wanted to show that with the help of images. So, let me skip some slides and move to those image slides over there, where we will be talking about the laminar and turbulent flows. So, let us say if we focus first on this image on the left hand side. So, this actually shows what we observe almost every day. We want to take bath in the bathroom and there we open the tap or the faucet. If the volumetric flow rate is very low, like it is shown over here. So, I will write low volumetric flow rate V dot. So, you see that the flow which is coming out is very smooth, it is not perturbed, it is not having any eddies or very low turbulence over there. And over here we can see highly turbulent flow which is taking place, some sort of a jet like formation which is taking place. And this has taken place because we have the high volumetric flow rate over here. So, we can clearly see in this particular case, it is the low Reynolds number case, and over here we have the high Reynolds number case. And this sketch on the top right hand side over here, this actually shows the difference between the laminar and the turbulent velocity profiles over here. So, you can see lot of vorticity over here taking place in turbulent region, but in the laminar region it is very very smooth. So, this is another way we can actually graphically show the huge difference is there between the laminar and turbulent flow. And what we are seeing in the third photograph on the bottom right hand side is that this is a candle which is giving out this sort of a smoke. This is a Schlieren photography. So, this is not actual the visible light it is giving out over here, but the Schlieren photography gives some sort of change in density refractive index. So, for that we are getting much better clarity over here. So, in the first zone which I can show with the red color over here, in this zone is having the lower Reynolds number, the flow is laminar, and over here we can clearly see a lot of eddies, vorticity, perturbed flow is there, then the flow has actually become turbulent. So, these figures are actually self-explanatory and this is something that we have seen in our day to day life. We all have lit some candles sometime, we all take out water from the tap. So, this is very good examples of these images. So, this one on the right hand side we have already seen, the same thing we are seeing in this particular small stream, that upstream over here the flow was not perturbed, it is laminar, and then suddenly over here it has become turbulent. So, even though in this particular case it is very interesting, maybe the Reynolds number might be same throughout, but if we are not having the smooth pipe or over here the surface is not smooth. Let us say even if the fluid over here was almost static, but if I give some sort of a vibration to it, then I am perturbing it. So, it is directly going into the turbulence I am generating over there. Then these are some images of jets which actually show lot of these vorticities. Lot of eddies which are actually visible over here. So, very nice photographs are available. So, they actually show huge amount of turbulence in the flow over here. And another interesting phenomena which takes place in flow, this is not about laminar and turbulent flow, but you can see this is some sort of a cylinder over here. So, this one we will classify as flow over a cylinder. Now, in real life, where have we seen the flow taking place over a cylinder? Some may say we have never seen that, but I will then claim that actually we all have seen it. And one effect that we will clearly see over here is that if I put some sort of a cloth behind it, so what we are seeing are these are eddies and vortices which are actually being shed, and it is going down over here. So, we can see one eddy over on the top, another eddy on the bottom over here, and this sort of a, if I put a cloth over here, so what cloth do we put in front of a cylinder? So, I will say this is a flag. So, we have all seen the flag, and in Hindi we call that the flag lehra raha hai, or in English it is swirling, the flag is moving like that. So, we have all seen if on the windy day the flag is doing something like this, it is actually because of this concept called the vortex shedding which is actually taking place, and you can clearly see on the top side, bottom side, it is not happening simultaneously. On the top side it is little bit left. So, what I am saying over here is that this center and this center is a kind of skewed a little bit. So, there is this distance which I think this animation is showing with the L over here. So, it is kind of trying to show the distance between subsequent vortices. And because of this effect, the flag is actually going up and down because of the presence of the cylinder, and that cylinder is the flag pole. So, in front of the flag there is a big flag pole. So, vortices are actually being shed on both sides of the flag pole. So, again some student may ask, sir, but why, where is the heat transfer taking place over here, right? Over here there is no temperature gradient right now. But then I will pose the question that if we look inside the evaporator coil of any air conditioner or the condenser coil of any air conditioner. So, condenser coil is easy to see because it is usually kept outside our house. This is the unit which dumps the heat to the atmosphere, or if you go to the roof, many people put their condenser units on the roof. So, over there we see lot of copper coils with lot of tubes over there. So, these are all tubes which are carrying hot refrigerant. And why do we put the condenser unit outside? Because we want to take away the heat from that hot refrigerant and dump it to the atmosphere. And why are we doing it? So, thermodynamic engineer can immediately remember that if I draw the TS diagram for the refrigeration cycle, what I am talking about is this particular part over here. So, if I put 1, 2, 3 and 4 and I make this in maybe green color, so my condenser is from 2 to 3. So, this is the condenser part over here. So, you can see it is having the maximum temperature in this particular cycle. So, in order to cool the refrigerant from temperature T2 to T3, which has to flow in this particular tube over here. So, all the green temperatures I am showing over here is T2 inlet temperature, and the outlet temperature I will show maybe in the blue color over here. So, all the refrigerant after cooling down, its temperature becomes T3. So, when air is actually passing over this row of tubes, so if I draw the cross section of these tubes over here, so one tube will look like this, another tube, then when we show the velocity profile, then that air is going like this, right? So, lot of vortex shedding is taking place over here as well. Then some manufacturer may actually go ahead and put it slightly differently. So, they may not put all the tubes in line, they may actually stagger it a little bit. So, sometimes the tubes are put like this. So, there is very good heat transfer actually taking place over here, then over here, then over here. So, in all these three cases, essentially an engineer is trying to use this equation H A T surface minus T infinity. So, in coming back to this particular slide over here, in this slide there is no heat transfer taking place, but what I am trying to imagine is that inside this particular cylinder, if it is hot or cold, very good heat transfer will take place with it along with the surrounding fluid. So, if that vortex shedding is taking place at particular Reynolds number, it does not take place at all Reynolds number, between certain Reynolds number it takes place. So, there that heat transfer coefficient also we can get some information by looking at this flow visualization. So, these things are all connected with one another. So, slowly and slowly we will look at it in subsequent lectures. Let us go further. And this is the same animation that we had talked about earlier. So, I think this one we have looked in more detail. Just let me tell again, if this is my glass A and glass B, so maybe one takeaway that students can take from today is that we can just by visualization we can kind of guess, but we do not know exactly how much high is the temperature in A, but we can clearly say that A temperature is much is higher than the of the temperature of B. So we go back to our slide that we were on earlier. We were talking about now, having looked at these photographs and animation, what was the motivation behind that? Now we can better understand the terms that I am talking about, that what is the laminar flow, what is turbulent flow. Based on that, we will be able to figure out, okay, what does the critical Reynolds number actually mean? It is the Reynolds number higher than which the flow actually becomes turbulent, and lower than that the flow remains laminar. So these two slides, 13th slide and 12th slide, we are looking at just the basics of fluid mechanics. But keeping in mind that all this study that we are doing as background, our objective is always to look at the eventual heat transfer, which we will do very soon over here. So that objective sight we will not lose. Now let me go ahead to the next slide over here. Oops. And maybe define two more parameters before we actually look at the convective heat transfer taking place. So the first parameter that I want to define is Nusselt number. So this one is named in the honor of scientist Nusselt, and it is given as HLC by K over here. Now some student may remember immediately that two lectures back we have also written one more equation, which was Biot number, if you remember, and there it was also HLC by K. So you may ask question that, sir, what is the difference between them? So please remember very carefully that that Biot number, thermal conductivity is of the solid, and in Nusselt number the thermal conductivity is of the fluid. So both are actually non-dimensionalized form of heat transfer, but over here in Nusselt number we are taking thermal conductivity of the fluid. And if I take that particular definition, thermal conductivity of the fluid, I can actually write it in this form: K of fluid divided by length delta T. So I am just multiplying numerator and denominator by delta T. So it kind of indicates the ratio of the convective heat transfer to the conduction heat transfer inside the fluid. So both are for the fluid case. So this is one way, and another way of telling Nusselt number is that it is the non-dimensionalized form of H. So H was our convective heat transfer coefficient. If we non-dimensionalize it, then we get Nusselt number over here through this particular equation. Another parameter that I will define over here is the Prandtl number, and this is another scientist in whose honor this number is actually given, and this is given as nu divided by alpha, where we remember nu is the kinematic viscosity, which is given as mu by rho, and alpha is the thermal diffusivity, which is given by K by rho Cp. So if we take these ratios, essentially what we are telling is that this is, this particular parameter is Prandtl number. So this again is non-dimensional number, so it is a non-dimensional number. And like we have looked at the physical significance of Nusselt number, if somebody asks what is the physical significance of the Prandtl number, so it kind of gives the ratio of two diffusivities. So you can see nu is something on the top which is linked to momentum, and alpha, which is given at the bottom, is linked to heat, it is the thermal diffusivity. So what we will define as the numerator is the molecular diffusivity of momentum, and here it is the molecular diffusivity of mass. So this is the ratio over here. which means what are some fluids which have astronomically high diffusion of heat compared to diffusion of momentum. So, those are the fluids in which if I give some slight temperature rise throughout the fluid, the temperature will increase, compared to if I give little bit momentum rise, the throughout the fluid momentum will not increase. So, you can guess perhaps I am talking where heat transfer takes place very fast is sort of metal, and when will metal become liquid? At very high temperatures when we melt it. So, if you look at molten metal, molten aluminium, molten copper, molten iron, they will have very large denominator. If you look at this expression over here, the denominator says molecular diffusion of heat, that is the denominator, right? Which means Prandtl number for molten metals or liquid metal will have very large denominator, which means Prandtl number will be very less. So, if I write that table over here, and over here I write the Prandtl number for various materials. So, the lowest material, the lowest value will be for liquid metals. So, this is liquid metals, okay. And which will be the one which will be having the highest Prandtl number over here? Between 2000 and 1 lakh, such high Prandtl number. So, that will be a fluid or a liquid, some sort of a fluid rather, where heat transfer, if I am giving little bit, it is not taking place, but momentum transfer is taking place very fast. So, that type of example is glycerin. Because glycerin is highly viscous. So, if you look at the viscosity of glycerin, it is very high. So, viscosity high means that the momentum transfer is taking place very fast. Then we look at oils, then we have water, and then we have gas. So, gas has Prandtl number close to 1, water is somewhere between 1 and 13 depending on its temperature, and oils have somewhere between 50 to 1 lakh. So, these are the typical values of Prandtl number. And from here, Prandtl number is one very good parameter, which is actually directly linking heat and momentum together. So, if I put some green circles over here, so this is directly a ratio of momentum and heat. And in the next lecture, when we begin, we will actually try and see that when flow takes place over a heated surface, how does the heat transfer takes place from it, and how does the momentum transfer also takes place from it. And very interesting thing because of that is, if flow is taking place and some surface we put in between, then the flow tries to take that, pull that surface along with it, and that is exactly because the momentum is trying to drag with it, and we call it drag force. So, when we are driving a car, the reverse thing happens, we are trying to move very fast, the air is still, it is trying to resist that movement, and lot of our that mileage that we get out of car, that lot of energy that we are losing is just because of the drag force which is taking place on the car. So, this momentum transfer and heat transfer with fluid is actually very, very important. So, once we come back in next lecture, we will start from where we have left off over here, and thank you very much.